In this video, we will review the basic approach one should consider when interpreting an ECG. This covers only the basics and is a very high-level overview of the process with very little detail. We are currently developing a course which covers each step in detail with a lot of example ECGs as we go. The idea is to understand the basic approach, which is to analyze the rhythm, describe the P wave, which represents atrial depolarization, the PR interval, which represents the time between atrial and ventricular depolarization, the QRS complex to identify structural and conduction abnormalities within the ventricles, and the ST segment and T wave, which also provides additional information regarding any structural and conduction abnormalities within the ventricles. The first step is to analyze the rhythm by commenting on the regularity, complex width, and heart rate. Here, the main goal is to identify the origin of the electrical impulse. Is it coming from above or within the ventricles, known as supraventricular or ventricular rhythms, respectively? One can determine this by looking at the width of the QRS complex. Narrow or normal complexes typically have a supraventricular origin, whilst wide or broad complexes are typically ventricular. One should comment on the regularity of the rhythm, whether it fires at the same regular intervals, and then lastly on its rate. The rate is determined by counting the number of complexes within a rhythm strip and multiplying that with the appropriate number depending on how the ECG has been calibrated. In this video, we will assume all rhythm strips are 10-second rhythm strips. Therefore, the number of complexes will be multiplied by 6 to calculate how many complexes there would be in 60 seconds. This 10-second rhythm strip shows a regular narrow complex tachycardia, whilst this is an irregular narrow complex tachycardia. Given that both complexes are narrow, they both have a supraventricular origin. Given both heart rates are above 100 beats per minute, they are both tachycardic. However, one fires regularly, whilst the other irregularly. The next step is to describe the P wave by commenting on its location, axis, and morphology. This helps us to further specify the origin of the electrical impulse. The P wave represents atrial depolarization. During atrial depolarization, note that the right atrium starts to depolarize before the left atrium. This makes sense because the SA node is located within the right atrium. It is also important to note that the x-axis represents time on an ECG. Therefore, the net effect or deflection captured on an ECG trace is as follows. This is a normal P wave. It is monophasic, has an amplitude or height of less than 2.5 millimeters. When looking at the location, there is typically a P wave that precedes every complex. A P wave axis is considered normal when the P wave is upright or positive in lead 2 and negative or upside down in lead AVR. This is so because typically the electrical activity in the heart moves in this direction, towards lead 2 and away from AVR. A normal P wave axis in a supraventricular rhythm suggests that the rhythm originates from the sinoatrial node. Lastly, one should comment on the morphology, which should be constant. Changing P wave morphology suggests that the origin of the impulse is constantly changing, as seen in a wandering atrial pacemaker. Other changes may include P pulmonale, or peaked P waves, as seen in a right atrial enlargement, and P mitrale, or M-shaped P waves, as seen in left atrial enlargement. Step 3 involves commenting on the PR interval, which represents the time taken for electrical impulse to move between the atria and ventricles. A prolonged PR interval suggests that a heart block exists between the atria and ventricles, and a short one suggests that there is an accessory pathway bypassing the AV node. Step 4. In this step, we aim to identify if there's any structural or conduction abnormalities within the ventricles by looking at the QRS complex. One needs to comment on the QRS width, the cardiac axis, and voltage. Certain voltage criteria exist to identify ventricular hypertrophy. Furthermore, one needs to review each wave, the Q, R, and S wave, individually to identify specific abnormalities such as pathological Q waves in contiguous leads, the R wave progression in the limb leads, and criteria for conditions such as left anterior fascicular block. Lastly, step 5 involves reviewing the ST segment and T wave, and are usually assessed to identify ventricular injury due to compromised cardiac perfusion, which may occur from ischemia or infarction. These changes will be seen in contiguous leads. Infarction can present with ST elevations in contiguous leads, whilst ischemia can present with T-wave inversions in contiguous leads. Abnormal T-waves may also be caused by electrolyte disturbances, such as hyperkalemia. To summarize, we have reviewed the basic steps to interpreting an ECG, and at each step can identify certain abnormalities such as arrhythmias, atrial enlargement, heart blocks, accessory pathways, ventricular hypertrophy, cardiac ischemia, cardiac infarcts, or hyperkalemia.